Okay, I'm delighted to be here to talk about gravitational waves. So gravitational waves are a new tool that we have at our disposal to explore the universe. They were predicted by Albert Einstein in two papers in 1916 and 1918. They are a consequence of the Einstein equations, which I wrote there, that represent the interplay between curvature on the left-hand side and the energy-momentum tensor on the right-hand side. They are produced by the accelerated motion of big objects in the universe, like black holes and neutron stars. And here on the left, you have a still picture of a simulation that we did in 2015, when we had the first merger of two black holes detected by the LIGO and Virgo collaboration. You can barely see actually the two black holes in the middle of this picture here. So I will briefly touch on these topics here. So I will try to explain how we decode the gravitational waves, which kind of information they have brought to us from the deep and dark universe, and which challenges in theory and data analysis we have to tackle if we want to take advantage of the discovery potential of ever more sensitive detectors in the future. In fact, let me briefly say how we detect gravitational waves. We use the way in which gravitational waves interact with freely falling bodies, like you see here, a ring of particles, and we use interferometers where the free particles are the mirrors that hang by wires at the extremity of the Fabry-Perot cavities, and they are free of moving above a few hertz. And here you see the picture of the LIGO detector in the US, Virgo just outside Pisa, and we have also a Japanese detector called Kagra. And we monitor the displacement of the mirrors that are put in motion by the gravitational wave that pass by at the level of a 10,000th of a proton diameter, because this is what we need in order to measure the amplitude of the gravitational waves, which is extremely weak. The wave produced by black holes and neutron stars. Now, the main topic, the main sources here are binary systems, and we have the luxury that we can solve the Einstein equation to predict the shape of this waveform. And so to detect them, we use match filtering or signal processing. And let me show you with an animation how do we do that. We have a bank of templates here in pink. We correlate with the data. Likely, if we have a signal in the data, the correlation goes up, or the signal-to-noise ratio, and then we can claim a detection if that threshold is passed and the threshold is fixed by the property of the noise that we know in the detector. And we need many, many templates. We need hundreds of thousands of them, or millions of them, when we do the follow-up analysis using Bayesian methods. So in this plot here, I'm showing you what happened after 2015. In the last 8 years, almost 100 gravitational wave signals have been detected by LIGO and Virgo, and we put them in what we call the stellar graveyard. On the y-axis here, you have the solar ma the mass of the black hole and neutron star in solar masses. So this was the very first event detected the 14th of September 2015. This is the still picture of a simulation that we did. And the way of understanding this plot is, so you have one black hole, another black hole, and they merge, and they form a black hole, which has a mass more or less the sum of the masses minus the energy that is emitted in gravitational waves. The 17th of August 2017, we discovered the first fusion of two neutron stars, which also ushered in the field of multi-messenger astrophysics with gravitational waves, because a lot of electromagnetic counterparts were found. Then afterwards, the 21st of May 2019, we discovered the largest binary black hole so far. One of the two black holes has a mass 100 times the mass of the Sun, is posing also some challenges to theoretical astrophysicists, understanding how they could form from the collapse of stars. And finally, I wanted to highlight another one, which was detected the 14th of August 2019, because in this case, the secondary mass, we don't know if it is a black hole or a neutron star. The mass is too large to be the one of a neutron star and too small to be the one of a black hole. And the last one I wanted to highlight is the first mixed binary, because you would say we detect two neutron star merging, two black holes merging. Well, one was missing, the neutron star black hole that was discovered the 15th of January 2020. And you see here a simulation and the visualization of a simulation of the neutron star and black hole going around each other. And because of the properties, the spin and the mass of the black hole and neutron star in this case, the black hole swallows the neutron star whole and doesn't leave any accretion disk. But in the future, we might actually have cases in which the neutron star is disrupted before merging into the black hole, forming a disk around with an electromagnetic counterpart. Now, what I want to highlight, in order to extract all this information, we have to predict the waveform with very high accuracy. We are interested in the waveform because, as I wrote here, they are fingerprints of the source, the astrophysical source that has emitted them. In this visualization, you see the five binary black holes detected by LIGO and Virgo and a binary neutron star, very long signal. Forgot to say that the bandwidth of the detector, the frequency bandwidth, is between 20 Hz and a kilohertz, okay? So what happened is that the gravitational wave frequency is a multiple of the orbital frequency in the binary. And if you remember the Kepler law from perhaps high school, you learn that the orbital frequency is inversely proportional to a certain power of the separation between the two objects in the binary. And the binary, the two objects are getting closer and closer because the energy is emitted in gravitational waves, so the binding energy is decreasing. And so at some point, the two objects will merge with each other, and that happens on a frequency which is given by this formula, where m is the total mass of the binary in unit of the mass of the sun. So because a binary neutron star, the neutron star have a small mass, this number is in the kilohertz, and that's why the neutron star is very, very long, because it merges in the kilohertz. But the black holes have a larger mass, and they merge in the 100 hertz, and that's why the signals are shorter. Now, you can imagine you continue to increase the mass of the black hole. At some point, they are going to merge outside the bandwidth of the detector, and in fact, we have to go in space, as you will see in a moment. Now, the information on the binary is imprinted, as I was saying, in the waveform. So this is a typical waveform. You see the increase of the frequency over time. From the frequency evolution, we infer the masses in the binary. From the amplitude and the masses, we can infer the distance where the binary was with respect to the Earth. From the time of arrival, the amplitude and the phase are the three detectors we have on the Earth. We can infer the sky location. And if we see modulations of this kind in the signal, we can understand whether the two objects were moving on a circular orbit or elliptic or eccentric orbit. And we can even learn whether the black holes were spinning or neutron stars were spinning or where they had no spin. And finally, if we compare with theory that are not general relativity, theory of gravity different from general relativity, we can probe the theory of gravity. So in order to predict this waveform, we have to solve what we call the two-body problem in general relativity. And this problem is very complicated because the Einstein equations are nonlinear equations, where this quantity, the curvature, depends nonlinearly on the metric, g mu nu, and its derivatives. And on one side, we can solve this problem on supercomputers numerically. So we can span a region in the parameter space of the mass ratio, the separation in the binary, et cetera, with numerical relativity. But to produce only 15, 20 orbits, it takes 1 month. And so we cannot just use numerical relativity to build the template banks of 100,000 and million of waveforms. And so we have other methods to solve the Einstein equation, which I wrote down here, and they are approximate methods. Then we put all these methods together in the effective one-body theory, and we improve the theory using results from numerical simulations. So this is what we do. Now, I wanted to make an example of how we use this waveform, to test, for example, the theory of general relativity. And this is a new regime in which we can test the theory. The theory has been well tested in the solar system. For example, you can remember the Mercury precession of Mercury. But this is a new regime because the two bodies are going around each other. They dynamically, you know, merge with each other. So let me tell you that black holes, if you take a black hole and you perturb a black hole, the black hole emits normal modes, or actually quasi-normal modes. And now these black holes that form after the merger, so there were two black holes going around each other merging, after the merger, they produce this quasi-normal mode, a black hole that forms, because it's a bit perturbed and emits quasi-normal modes. And now, if we can, if you remember, if you have electromagnetic spectral lines, that you can identify chemical elements, hydrogen and neon and beryllium, and this can happen also for black holes because the quasi-normal modes only depend on the mass and the spin of the black hole. So if you can basically measure this quasi-normal mode, you can understand whether the black hole is the black hole in general relativity or something else. And until now, general relativity has passed this test, and in fact has passed many, many tests, tens of tests that we have done, and so the theory is still valid until now. Okay, so let me tell you now about the future. So first of all, this is just the detectors that have been operating until now. We are at the fourth observing run, which started last May, and these numbers here tells you the distance at which this detector can see a binary neutron star coalescence. The fact that the numbers are increasing means that we are more and more sensitive to a larger volume, which is good. Now, in the last run, just since May, we have detected 60 new gravitational wave signals, basically one every 3 days, which is very good. Then the interferometers will stop for a few years and come online almost at the end of this decade for the last run. Early in 2030, we will have some upgrades called A sharp and Virgo for LIGO and Virgo. But the big jump will happen next decade with hopefully new facilities on the ground. And here is the picture of the Einstein telescope that we would like to build in Europe underground and Cosmic Explorer in the US. In which way these interferometers are going to improve the sensitivity? They are going to be more sensitive, so they are going, with respect to LIGO, to reach larger distances or larger redshift. This is the redshift imparted to the wavelength as the universe expands, so the larger is the redshift, more, you know, into the past we can go. And also, they are going to expand to lower frequency, up to the 1 Hz, bringing basically in band black holes to larger mass. I was telling you before, we are limited by the bandwidth. If the mass becomes larger than 100 solar masses, we cannot see them with LIGO and Virgo. But this detector will allow actually to go to larger black holes and much larger distances at the time when the first stars formed in the universe. Now, it's overwhelming to think of the number of detection that we are going to have. So in only 1 year, with a signal-to-noise ratio one order of magnitude larger than what we can do today, we could see 10,000 of black holes just in 1 year. Now, remember, today we are measuring one black hole every 3 days. And we could also see of the order of 500 binary neutron stars with such large signal-to-noise ratio that we could actually nail down the composition of the neutron stars. So the science case of the Einstein Telescope and Cosmic Explorer is really overwhelming, touching, you know, probing gravity and the theory of of Albert Einstein, even with more precision, fundamental physics, understanding how these black holes and neutron stars come from, and also understanding the dense matter, which is at the core of the neutron stars. But this is not just the end. So in the next decade, we will have also a mission in space called LISA. In fact, this mission is going to be adopted soon in January by the European Space Agency with a large participation also from the US, NASA. It's a beautiful experiment with the 3 satellites in a triangular configuration going around the sun just behind the Earth. And this will open a completely new bandwidth around the millihertz. So before we were talking about the hectohertz, 1 hertz, and I was telling you if you want to look at black holes of million solar masses at the center of our galaxy forming binary and merging with each other, you have to go in space. You cannot do it on the ground. And this plot shows the noise spectral density of the detector and the tracks of signals coming from the merger of two black holes with very large signal-to-noise ratio. This signal can be seen for an entire year, spanning in the bandwidth of the detectors. We are going to see small objects like a small stellar mass black hole or neutron star going around the massive black holes, the so-called extreme mass ratio in spirals, and they will go around for millions of cycles, of gravitational wave cycles, probing the multiple structure of the black holes with exquisite precision. Now, from the point of view of theory and data analysis, this new experiment next decade poses a lot of challenges because now we are going to have many, many events happening at the same time, overlapping with each other. Many signals of different kind will be there all the time. So from the point of view of data analysis, this is very challenging because we have to, first of all, in principle, we don't know how many of these events there are in the data, and we have to extract them one after the other. So this means we have to improve, for this precision gravitational wave astronomy, all the waveform that we've been developing up till now by several orders of magnitude. And we have to include all possible effects because the signal-to-noise ratio will be so high that we are going to see even the fact that the two bodies are perturbed by perhaps a third body that is going around or that they are in accretion disk and not just in vacuum. So let me tell you about this. So I have here just an illustration. This is a black hole here with an accretion disk. You can have binary systems in accretion disk or single body that go around the black hole. You can have other bodies that perturb the motion of them. And for each of them, the waveforms are very different. And we have actually to predict all of them in order to resolve them and dig out them from the noise. And the other example I wanted to make is that maybe you are familiar with gravitational lensing in electromagnetic astronomy that produce multiple images of the same source because there is a lens between the source and the telescope. And quite incredibly, this happens also for gravitational waves. If you have a binary black hole and there is a lens, and then here is your experiment, the signal will be modified depending on the mass of the lens. These are some examples. The lens signal is in black, and the color signal is the lens one, which you can see you can have even echoes. After the merger, you can have multiple echoes. It's quite interesting that in the last few years, a new community coming from energy physics that has been working on the problem of providing accurate results for quantum chromodynamics has moved actually to this field. And we are using techniques from effective field theory, quantum field theory, with application to the classical gravity case, the two-body case, where actually the black hole, yes, I finished, and the black hole actually is treated as an elementary particle. So I will skip this slide, and I'm going to actually have, I finish with this simulation of two black holes going around each other. What you see is the power radiated in unit of the luminosity in the sun, and the multiple here actually is 10 to the 22, as you can see here. So this is the radiation that is in all direction, but in particular in the direction perpendicular to the orbital plane. And going toward yellow means that the flux is increasing until the two bodies merge with each other, where the luminosity is 10 to the 23, the luminosity of the sun. So I want to finish thanking my group because a lot of work I showed actually they are responsible for that, and also the agencies and the LIGO-VIGO and Kaga collaboration. Thank you very much for your attention.